Greetings and welcome to People's Guide to the Cthulhu Mythos. I am your host, DB Spitzer, and today we're going to explore the world of the Cthulhu Mythos, and we're going to talk about some other stuff. Today, let's talk about the Migo, since all that Pluto stuff's going on, and, let's also talk about another podcast, or another series of podcasts based off of one podcast, which is now becoming the first podcast people listen to. That's kind of a weird thing, considering that it's only a 12-part podcast that hasn't been on the air for some time now and won't be back on the air for until next fall. I'm talking about Serial. So the first half of the show today is going to be kind of lighthearted, goofy, aliens, Pluto, and the second part, not so much. It's going to be kind of a downer a little bit, talking about a dead teenage girl in Baltimore, 1999, someone who may have been wrongly accused or at least convicted on evidence that shouldn't have been used. Oh, not used, but shouldn't have been made up by the Baltimore police. I'm just going to say that. Whether or not people did what they did, said what they did, that's for other people to find out. I'm not a detective. I'm just an amateur podcaster. But we'll be talking about Serial after the second music break. Speaking of music, today's music is by Liam Lynch, who is responsible for Syphil and Ollie and the song United States of Whatever. And there will be some music by Nick Thornburn titled Bad Dream. When you hear it, you'll know it, unless you don't listen to Serial. Let's get on with the podcast. Let's start the show. Let's stop this goofing off and get into some goofy stuff. So I planned this episode a little bit ago, and I don't really pay attention to science news all that much anymore. I mean, I'll click on stuff on IO9, or if something on the Twitter feed or the Facebook feed or something like that is sciencey, I'll be like, I'm smart enough, I know about science, I can follow this, I'll pay attention. I didn't know we had a satellite going past Pluto when I was about to do a Migo episode. And you're going, well, who are the Migo? As I crinkle papers in the background and grab my legal pad where I keep all my notes. The Migo are an extraterrestrial race created by H.P. Lovecraft. First spoken of in A Whisper in Darkness in 1931. Lovecraft wrote this between, I think, March and September of 1931, and in the end of it, when he's talking about the Migo, there is a new planet discovered, a planet called Yagoth, but we terrestrials know it as Pluto. So, I think Lovecraft had written the story and was like, I don't know, it's just something missing. And I don't know why Lovecraft sounds like a bad Vincent Price impersonation. That was a really bad Vincent Price impersonation. I'm not 100% sure, but I kind of have this feeling that Lovecraft wrote the story, and while revising it, word of Pluto came down, because Pluto was discovered in June or July. Let's see, one click to another tab. Boom.
Pluto, minor planet designation 134340. Pluto is a dwarf in the Kuiper Belt, a ring of bodies beyond Neptune. It was discovered,
February 1930. I thought something. Pluto was discovered 1930 by Clyde Tombaugh. Ninth planet from the sun. Okay, all right. And Whisper in Darkness was written from February to September 1930. Pluto was discovered. Pluto was discovered in February. So was the discovery of Pluto the antithesis? Not the antithesis, the starting point. The starting point. That's the word I'm looking for. That means starting point. That's not antithesis. Synthesis? Oh, I don't know. Catalyst? What word am I looking for? Write me and tell me what word. Tweet me and be like, hey, dum-dum. You're looking for this word. Anyway, Pluto. Did you know Pluto has 5 moons, Charon being the largest, Styx, Nix, Kerberos, and Hydra? I think that the Migo probably are rocking it out on Hydra most of the time. And anyway, so I didn't know the satellite was going past Pluto. And I was like, oh, I'll do something about the Migo. And I had no idea that New Horizons was going to be flying past Pluto last week. So, yeah, we've got some really great pictures of Pluto. Still no pictures of the Migo on it, but you know they're there. You know they're lurking. And every time they talk about chasms or canals or anything like that on Pluto or any of its moons, I'm like, you know what's in there. Fungi from Yagoth. You know, what they call Pluto. And I think according to Delta Green, they talk about, which I covered in the last episode, I believe, Delta Green. Or was that an episode or two ago? I don't know. We covered that the Migo... We talked about Delta Green. We didn't talk about the Migo within Delta Green. But the Migo in Delta Green, Yagoth is just a settlement. It's a settlement on the edge of our solar system before going further out into the cosmos. Let's see, what else can we talk about with the Migo? Well, the Migo are crustacean-like fungus creature that are pinkish-purplish. What are they, the size of... They're bigger than dogs. They're like people-sized or cow-sized? I can't remember. Yeah. They're gross. take human brain... Celestial... I don't know. Okay. Maybe just mammalian or brains or I don't know. They take the type organs of various creatures and put them in cylinders so that they can survive the process that the Migo use to transfer themselves around space-time. I think just space, but it might be space-time as well. It's really hard to say with Lovecraft. I don't believe that the Migo or any sort of multidimensional, but then again, they do use their wings to fly through the ether of outer space, which doesn't function on Earth. So I'm starting to think maybe that they are some sort of fourth dimensional creature that uses a dimension that we're... Oh, multidimensional, not necessarily fourth dimensional. Multidimensional creatures that use some sort of... something that we ourselves can't attach to, something we can't deal with, some sort of aether. Also, let's see, what else do we know about the Migo? They worship Narlathotep, who we really haven't covered yet, but we will soon, and Shub-Niggurath, the goat with 1,000 youngs, the dark goat of the woods with 1,000 young. So yeah, if you're unfortunate enough to run across the Migo, they may just straight up kill you, or they may trick you into being one of their minions, and if you're a good minion, they may scoop up your brain, put it in a cylinder, and let you explore the cosmos with them. And they worship the elder gods. So let's talk about what else we know about the Migo. The Migo are referred to in the Mountains of Madness. Went to war with the Elder Things long before people existed. Let's see. In Delta Green, the Migo are actually the alien race that controls what we know as the Gray, but they use the Gray as, like, meat puppets. And these meat puppets are the ones who interact with humanity, and the Migo control... Well, they interact with a subset of the CIA called Majestic 12. You know, you have to have Majestic clearance to even talk about this stuff. This isn't even Delta Green Eyes only. This is Majestic, dudes. Yeah. Migo, they love surgery, they love science, they love space. And, wow, I thought I was going to have a lot more stuff about the Migo, but let's see. What else do I have about the Migo written down? They're in part of the anthology film Necronomicon. Brian Usna, I think, did that one. Pretty sure. I don't think it was Stuart Gordon. I think it was Brian Usna. Yep. Did that. And, here's one I just remembered. Migo? Is the Tibetan word for Yeti. And Lovecraft talks about how, I think it's Lovecraft who talks about it.
The Abominable Ones in Himalayan, nickname for a race of extraterrestrials in Cthulhu mythos created by H.P. Lovecraft and others. The name was first applied to the creature in Lovecraft's story, Whisper in Darkness, 1931. Elaborate on a reference to what fungi sprout in Yoggoth in his sonnet cycle, Fungi from Yoggoth, 1929-1930, which described the contrasting vegetation on alien dream worlds.
Thank you, Wikipedia. That was really, really good. Origin of the word. Okay, here we go. Origin of the word from Wikipedia.
It is possible that Lovecraft encountered the word Migo in his readings. Migo is the Tibetan equivalent of the Yeti, an ape-like cryptid said to inhabit the high mountain ranges of that region. While the Migo of Lovecraft's mythos is completely unlike the Migo of Tibetan stories, Lovecraft seems to equate the two, as can be seen in the following excerpt from Whisper in Darkness.
Lubricate my throat with some Rockstar energy drink.
Rockstar. When you want a lot of energy, and you want your poop to fly out real fast. Rockstar. It was no use to demonstrate to such opponents that the Vermont myths differed but little in essence from those universal legends to natural personification, which filled the ancient world with fauns and dryads and satyrs, suggested by the of modern Greece, and gave to the wild Wales and Ireland their dark hints of strange, small, and terrible hidden races of troglodytes and burrowers. No use either to point out even more startling similar beliefs in the Nepalese hill tribes of the dreaded Migo, or abominable snowmen, who lurk hideously amidst the ice and rock pinnacles of the Himalayan summits. When I brought up this evidence, my opponents turned it against me, claiming it must imply some actual hypocrisy for the ancient tales. That it must argue the real existence of some queer elder earth race, driven into hiding by the advent and dominance of mankind, which might conceivably have survived in reduced numbers to relatively recent times. Or even the present, H.P. Lovecraft, Whisperer in Darkness.
So, where did where did the Migo come from? Well, okay, Migo came from beyond our solar system, but on a literary note, where did the Migo come from? We know that the Migo were first published in Whisper in Darkness, a short story by H.P. Lovecraft written in 1930, first published in Weird Tales in 1931. Similar to Color Out of Space, it was a blend of science fiction and horror, and let's throw some philosophy in there just for fun. It makes numerous references to other things in the Cthulhu mythos without actually being a major part of the Cthulhu mythos. So some people say, and by some people, I'm going to say the Reverend Robert M. Price, one of the foremost scholars on the Cthulhu mythos, talked about how it's a kind of a Lovecraft rewriting novel of the Black Seal by Arthur Machen. Most people don't really know Arthur Machen, to my knowledge. I mean, people don't read Arthur Machen unless they're reading, like, late 19th century horror and science fiction and fantasy. Just like people don't really know Lord Dunsany unless they read a lot of fantasy stuff. And people generally don't read the two unless they're getting their PhD in traditions of the Gothic literature. I think that's what my friend Drew has his PhD in. He's the one who was like, "You don't know Machen? It's awesome, like Transformers and Star Trek cards in Duluth, Minnesota." And you haven't read The Three Imposters? That's preposterous. So in both cases, we have an antiquarian professor who is interested in something that other people dismiss as superstitious, but more or less has something to do with the traditions and oral history of various native populations, sma folk or fairies, fairies or cryptids in general. So we got that, and that's where that comes from. So you have like the remote hills of Vermont, which one of my friends, she grew up in Vermont and says even to this day that hills rise wild with degenerate hill folk. That's a nicer way of putting it than what she actually said. I think she said that there are a bunch of incestuous hillbilly folk who live you know what? I don't want to enrage the one listener I have in Vermont, or two, or any. I don't know if I have any listeners in Vermont, but, you know, I'm not going to talk shit about Vermont, because that's where everyone's favorite overpriced ice cream comes from. How come Ben & Jerry's doesn't have a Migo flavor? That would be really cool. That would be awesome. I would, like, if Ben & Jerry's had a lactose-free dairy alternative Vermont Migo thing, I would be all about that. back to this. So Migo, it's a combination of actual mythology with the Yeti in the Himalayas, and then kind of stealing some stuff from Arthur Machen, because if there's one thing that Lovecraft does well, is steal from other authors that he likes. Yeah. So, you have this guy who gets letters from someone out in Vermont. You have newspaper articles, very much going back to the Gothic tradition of newspaper articles to give your story more of a realism, like Dracula, Bram Stoker's Dracula. interspersed with bits of things that make you feel like it could be a real thing. It references real places, it references real things, and if someone was to look up, you know, Tibetan Yeti stuff, they would run across the word Migo. So, already you have a story fairly steeped in the Gothic tradition. Do I have to have an episode about the Gothic tradition, or are we all on board with that? If not, just go to Wikipedia and look up the Gothic tradition, or... Now, that's me throwing my shoes off.
That sound brought to you by Adidas. Adidas. When you want to look like an athlete, but all you're going to be doing is walking around. Adidas.
So, let's talk about this story that it comes from initially. Whisperer in Darkness. So, you got this guy, Albert N. Wilmarth. We'll just call him Al. Who is an instructor of Lit at Miskatonic University in Arkham, Math. We've talked about Arkham before. I don't think we've talked about Miskatonic University to any length. Anyway, so the newspapers start talking about some flooding and lobstrosities washing up in the rivers. And it's not the first time that's happened. It's happened in the past as well. He starts receiving letters from this guy named Henry Wentworth Eckley. We'll call him Hank. So Hank lives in a isolated farmhouse way out in Vermont in Hillbillyville. He's like, I've got all kinds of proof. I've got some recordings and yeah. So he sends two letters and a recording, and Hank is also talking about how these lobstrosities, they're cultists, their followers are harassing him nightly and messing with his dog and stealing his mail and doing all kinds of stuff that people do to cranky old folks who live alone in the woods. So Hank shoots at these guys and his guard dogs are killed, even though I think Hank may have accidentally shot his own guard dogs. Or, you know, we'll talk more about that. Anyway, I'm sure at this point in time, Al's like, oh, this guy's crazy. He's like, whoa, what did that come up on your side too? That, okay. So Hank convinces Al to come out to his farmhouse, which I personally would not do. He writes that he's met the extraterrestrials and that they're peaceful. This is after, you know, they're harassing me. They killed my dog. They're peeking in my windows and busting up my stuff. So he's like, they are totally peaceful. They've taught me things that will blow your mind all beyond imagination. And he urges Al to come pay him a visit, bring along the letters, the photographic evidence, everything. Thing. Wilmarth's like, no. And the guy's like, come on. You should really come out here. You should really come out here. And he's like, no. And then he does. He goes out. And Al finds Hank in like really shitty condition. He's like immobilized in a chair, sitting in the darkness. And he tells Al that the aliens are amazing and they can put your brain in a jar and fly you all around space. But your brain has to go into a jar. Otherwise, you'll die. That's the only way. Human body, a lot of bodies, way too fragile to space. Rock, fly around stuff. Hank is like, yeah, there's a cylinder with my name on it right over there. Go look at it. Al also listens to a brain in a cylinder as it speaks of the positive aspects of the Migo and telling Al, oh yeah, you should totally do this. We'll go to Yoggoth. It'll be rad. Wilmerth is like really creeped out and really kind of weirded out by how Hank is talking in like a buzzing whisper. And so Al goes to bed, hears some weird stuff in the middle of the night, really weird kind of buzzing voices and stuff like that. And then once it's quiet, he goes downstairs and he finds that Hank is no longer there, but instead just the gross robe, and also in the robe are discarded facsimiles of face and hands. And then that's the end of the story. Yeah. And, you know, talks about like the historic floods of 1927 in Vermont. Yeah, Robert M. Price talks about how Wilmerth is like the model Lovecraftian protagonist. Starts out blissfully ignorant, only to learn the terrible truth far too late. Something about Whisper and Darkness that really kind of resonates with like the whole Gothic tradition. And this is like, you can see prime examples of this aspect of the Gothic tradition in, like, okay, this is a little on the nose, but Dracula, Bram Stoker's Dracula, newspaper articles and clippings and things that, like, actual events that give some credence to what the story is. Like, maybe if you're reading it in a pulp magazine or in, like, a popular fiction magazine or something like that, you'd be like, wait a minute, I remember hearing about those floods of 1927. Oh, I'm going to go look up this Migo thing or Himalayan Yeti stuff. It's like, whoa, it really is Migo. Is there any truth behind this? That's it for that. Let's see. How has it been turned into other stuff? As I said before, it was in the third segment of the Necronomicon, the film. And HPLHS made a feature-length film, which, you know, pretty good. I liked it. Did I mention that most Lovecraft stories have third-act problems, and HPLHS actually fixed that by including a third act? You know, the action sequences where Al is kind of a action hero, which most Lovecraftian protagonists aren't action-y guys. And if they bring action-y guys with them, they die. They die pretty quickly, or in the middle, or... Yeah. Yeah. I mean, middle of parts of story. Like, if you look at Call of Cthulhu, all the tough sailor guys died on Riley, however you want to pronounce it. And, what is it? Burrowers Beneath? No. Which one is it? The one with the degenerate family that you can tell that who they are is based off of, like, their eyes. And, you know, it's like, I took my two strong male bodyguards and we slept in the decrepit house. And when I woke, they were both gone. Ooh. So, you know. Remember that. If you ever find yourself to be a Lovecraftian protagonist, be book learned, don't lift weights, and speak at least two languages. One of them should be an ancient language, but don't know it too well, or you might go batshit crazy. The Migo, Whisper in Darkness, enough. At this point in time, I would like to bring up the fact that People's Guide to the Cthulhu Mythos is actually sponsored by Joe Pie. Go to Facebook, look up Joe Pie, and if you live in the Portland metro area, you can get a pie for my brother Joe. He makes really good pies. He's just learning how to make He's just started making lemon meringue and key lime pies. I've helped him develop the recipes for the crust and the fillings. I, being a professional chef who graduated from the Cordon Bleu in Portland back when it was a small culinary program ran by alcoholic Swiss Deutsch chefs. I taught my brother some stuff about baking, but he makes blueberry pies, strawberry raspberry pies, and all kinds of stuff like that. Not Joe's pie, not Joe Pies, Joe Pie. You know you'll find it if you see a pie with muscles. Like, kind of like if Trogdor had two arms and was a pie.
This is a global tell link. Prepaid call from an inmate, the Maryland Correctional Facility.
Is kind of how every episode of Serial starts. Really, this isn't anything to joke about. But what is Serial? Serial is a podcast that is a spin-off of NPR's This American Life. It is hosted by Sarah Koenig? I can never remember. And co-produced by Koenig and Julie Snyder, both producers of This American Life. So it started October 2014. It's won a Peabody Award and is really kind of ranked really high on iTunes a lot. It's about the basics of love, death, and justice, and truth. All these big things. Something that Koenig said specifically. She talks about kind of how it's weird to really get into the, I don't know, minute details of a teenager's life, of all the dumb things that they do and what they can and can't remember about their sex lives and just social life. Season one is about it's about the murder of a teenager named Haman Lee, who was a 18-year-old student at Woodlawn High in Baltimore, Maryland. Her body, or her corpse, was found in Leakin Park, not Lincoln Park, but Leakin Park, February 9th. She disappeared on January 13th, 1999, and I'm just going to save some people some time. No one knows who murdered her, honestly, but from all the evidence that's been coming out in the last year, it looks like the Baltimore police just wanted to close the case real quick, so they pinned everything on a guy that she had broken up with like less than a month prior by the name of Adnan Saeed, who is at the time was a 17-year-old student. They were both in the magnet program, which I guess is like smart kid classes at Woodlawn High. Adnan was on the track team, a devout Muslim, or as devout as you can be when you're 17, living in Baltimore and being a teenager, running around smoking pot. Not a bad kid, not doing like bad kid stuff or anything like that. Unless he did actually murder, but that's, we'll go into that. So it kind of seems like if you listen to it, and it kind of seems like a lot of the evidence against Adnan is either like manufactured to look like he did it, whether it be the cell phone tower evidence that is garbage, or the testimony of Jay Wilder, who was a guy that Adnan hung out with a bit, who he loaned his car to that day, who drove around and did stuff. And Adnan doesn't have like really good alibis for where he was the day that Haman Lee disappeared. He was arrested February 28th at 6 a.m. and charged with first-degree murder. And he should have been released on bail, but the Baltimore police fucked up his paperwork and had him listed as 18 instead of 17. And the judge didn't have any choice to post it so that his family could post bail. And the Muslim community was willing to put their houses up for collateral for bail money. I mean, this is a tight-knit community who was just looking to help. And it really didn't help that the prosecutors used garbage, just complete garbage information about how there was a lot of, like, young Pakistani males who would kill their girlfriends when jilted and then flee to Pakistan, which there were no cases like this. Jay Wilder's story changed from each time, and still, even with a recent interview in last January, changed one more time. It's a constantly changing thing, and I don't know. I'm just going to throw my personal theory, and that is the Baltimore police needed someone, couldn't find anyone, pinned it on some kid, and knew another guy who he was associated with and was like, hey, turn state's evidence, or we'll pin it on you. I don't know. Maybe something like that, maybe not. I'm just going to guess. Super amateur podcast. I don't really see anyone bringing me to court over the fact that I said this is my personal theory. I wouldn't say, yeah, this person did it, that person did it. I don't care. No, I do care. I do care. I care, like, I care about truth, and I care about, you know, someone not being in jail for something that they may or may not have done, hopefully that they didn't do. But the evidence isn't enough to really convict anyone. Yeah. I could talk about this for hours, honestly, because, well, Serial is 12 episodes. They cover all different things about the the case. And, yeah, all the different people involved in it. All kinds of things about, like, calls made that Adnan must have been there because Jay had his car at this period of time, and it's, oh man, you may get tired of hearing the name Nisha at one point in time and the Nisha call. At some point in time, you may think one of the sponsors is Best Buy, as many times as Sarah mentions Best Buy over and over again, and yeah. It's an interesting podcast, but there's some things that I don't like about it. One would be Saeed's defense attorney's voice, Gutierrez, is awful, awful, awful voice. It's just this terrible, terrible, screechy sing-song. Unfortunately, I guess she wasn't doing well health-wise and had some issues and probably wasn't in the best physical, emotional, or mental state to be defending someone. But they cover all kinds of stuff. I'm just all over the board right now. They cover the alibi and, you know, the breakup between Adnan and Hay. They talk about Mr. S., who is a streaker who found Hay's body in Leakin Park. They talk about the inconsistencies. They try and cover Adnan's day to try and prove that what the police say Adnan did and Jay did would have been or would not have been possible given how long it takes buses to leave Woodlawn High School. They analyze the case against Adnan Saeed and they start getting the Innocence Project involved, which, if you don't know what the Innocence Project is the Innocence Project is a nonprofit legal organization that is committed to exonerating wrongly convicted people through the use of DNA testing. And The project has led to freeing 329, currently 329 wrongly convicted people, including 18 who spent time on death row. They cover all kinds of stuff, but what they don't cover is whether or not he was guilty. They never prove if he did or if he didn't do it. A podcast that's related and I actually like a lot better. Serial is necessary to understand the background story for my personal favorite podcast that I'm going to be talking about, Undisclosed, which is... Undisclosed is a podcast listing and going through and reframing everything that you learned in Serial and showing it from different point of view. Serial is very much it's supposed to get you engrossed. The way that they dispense information is very episodic, very theme-driven, and gets you to come back. What Undisclosed does is it just tells you what's going on. It helps you understand the case and helps you... It's a very pro-Adnan podcast, which others are not. They are... I'll get into them, but they're not. And a major reason that Undisclosed is such a pro-Adnan podcast is the fact that it was started by Rabia Chaudhry, who is one of Adnan's friend's older sister who was going to law school when everything went down in 99. Also on Undisclosed is Colin Miller, who is listed as evidence professor, what? I can't remember. Evidence professor blog, that's right. And Susan Simpson, View from LL2, which I think that's her blog, but I can't remember. That's her blog. I just checked it. Check out their blogs. Rabia Chaudhry has Split the Moon, but they all work on Undisclosed, and they go through different bits of information. They uncover all kinds of stuff. They have a lot more people working with them and for them, and then you've got all the podcasters and people remembering things and stuff like that. And it's every new episode's on Monday evenings with amendum episodes on off weeks, but they really dive much more into the truth, and they cover things. Like, there are things that aren't really covered in Serial that Undisclosed goes into depth because, some things don't make as good podcasting if you're trying to tell a dramatic story, but if you're trying to shine light onto something, or if you have something that may make someone seem a little bit more sympathetic or may straight up damn someone else. And, Undisclosed is a little bit more biased towards Adnan. Some people said that Serial was not biased, and it sways back and forth as it's edited. I feel that probably SK felt certain ways at certain times, but edited it together so that it was, depending on the episode, how she felt, just edited it that way. I have to say, Good, Bad, and the Ugly, Undisclosed is the good. So let's get to the bad. Serial. Or the Serial by AV Club. It's a jokey mess. It's really hard for me to take the Serial podcast seriously. You might as well be reading a recap on some terrible sitcom or something, the way that they handle it. It's really unprofessional. It's really kind of sad how they joke about they joke about something that really isn't funny at all. I mean, I would hate to be Haman Lee's family in general. In general, I mean, I can't even imagine losing a child or a sibling. Think about that, cereal. Next one, if undisclosed is the good, cereal is the bad, serially obsessed is the ugly. It's terrible. It's a poorly produced podcast, and I thought Gutierrez's voice was terrible. The people that host this have terrible shrill voices. They don't take it seriously. They're really kind of shitty towards a lot of people, and it's just an asshole parade. Serially obsessed, you're an asshole parade. I've tried to listen to it, and I just can't. So, undisclosed is the good, the cereal is the bad, and serially obsessed is the ugly. Crime writers on ... cereal, on the other hand, it's its own series, I believe, Crime Writers On, but they do cover cereal. I don't know if they became a podcast before Serial or after, but it is one that I've actually really enjoyed. It's crime writers talking about Serial. It's hosted by two true crime writers that are also married, like a modern day Heart and Heart, except for the whole being rich thing, as they joke about in their blog. Rebecca and Kevin, I think it's Lori. They host it, and they're pretty smart about it. They're really smart. They've also got Laura Bricker, who's a freelance writer, who also is part of it. What's Toby's last name? Toby Ball. Okay. Anyway, It's smart. It's funny in parts, but it's appropriately funny. It's not like it's not like they're joking about how terrible of a bad liar Adnan is. I don't mind it when people talk shit about Jay and joke about how bad of a liar Jay is, because, man. And I do understand some gallows humor, but this is about a kid who never got to be an adult in the outside world, and about a girl who never, or a young woman who never got to grow up to be a woman. And yes, people die every day, but there's just something about this that joking about cereal just rubs me the wrong way. And I don't know, maybe I'm just a sensitive Gus, and I don't really like, I gotta change. I'm clicking around on the internet while I'm doing this, and Toby Ball's face is staring at me. So, there's all kinds of stuff. I really have to recommend Serial. I'm not gonna recommend Serially Obsessed unless you like terrible people. And unless you really have a huge giant boner for the AV Club, I'm not going to suggest the cereal. And there are a ton of other cereal podcasts out there. There's ones that cover all of the different cereal podcasts. And then there's other ones that are just like probably about the same level of professionalism as me, as in, I paid $30 for a microphone. I can say whatever the fuck I want. Level of investigative journalism. Let's see. Yeah, so that's... I don't know what else to really say. I think... just... I hope everyone out there... Man, this is so hard to talk about. I don't... God. There's stuff I want to talk about with this, but it's just like, I just really want to say... Listen to Serial. Like, what I've been doing is I listened to Serial while I walked, jogged, and ran, rode the bus, everything, while I made dinner, while I was running around town on my way to job interviews. I listened to Serial, and then I ran out of Serial in 2 days. I listened to all 12 episodes in 2 days, and then I was like, I need more. And Mel Evans at An Hour With Your Ex podcast suggested Undisclosed. So I checked it out. And thank you at Mel_Evans on the Twitter for recommending Undisclosed. It's a really good podcast. I really highly recommend it. If you want to know more than just the little bits and pieces here that SK was able to dig up for her NPR podcast. And if you listen to the podcasts already and you're listening to me, you may disagree, you may agree, whatever. I'm just glad that you're listening. And I think the main part about this, whether or not Adnan is guilty or innocent, this sheds a lot of light on the Innocence Project at University of Virginia Law School. They're doing the good work. They're clearing people's names and they're getting people out that didn't do what they did. Our nation has so many people in prisons that didn't do what they did. But then again, if you go to any prison, no one's guilty because no one said that they did what they... Yeah, you know the cliche. You know the cliche. I don't know what next episode's going to be about. I don't know. I kind of want to just talk for a little bit more till I feel better. Just... Man, it's a bummer. Just, everyone, just take care of each other. Just look out for each other. And don't loan your car to someone who you buy pot from just because their girlfriend needs a birthday present and you're friends with them. Just love each other. Make sure you're looking out for each other. And here's something else to think about. Don't post stupid shit in social media unless you've researched it. Go to Snopes or Scopes or whichever that thing's called. Research. Don't just go, Planned Parenthood selling baby parts on the black market. Look it up. Don't fill my social media feeds with your garbage. I only want kittens and food pictures, and I want to know how your marathons are, and actually, I don't care about marathons, dog pictures, food pictures, or anything like that. I don't know. I just, as I've stated in the past, I don't like Facebook. I use Facebook as a photo album, as an active photo album, and a way to check to see if people I know are alive or dead. Oh yeah, and if it's someone's birthday is there, so I can type HB for happy birthday, their initials, and exclamation point, and then boom, better than a birthday card, because it's on Facebook. And then I don't have to get them anything. Not even when Facebook goes, do you want to give them a Starbucks gift card? And I'm like, no, Facebook, Starbucks gift cards are gross. You can't eat them or drink them. You have to take them to a Starbucks. And Starbucks used to be good a long, long, long time ago, but you had to live in the Pacific Northwest for that. And you had to live in a very small part of the Pacific Northwest to even enjoy it. And then they're like, what can we do so everyone can experience Starbucks the same no matter where they go? I know, we'll roast our coffee too long. It'll be universally bad, but we'll be like, no, no, burnt coffee's supposed to taste like this. Seriously? Starbucks, you ruined coffee. You ruined coffee in the Pacific Northwest. Coffee People was awesome. Kobo's Company, I think it's still out there. Awesome. So many cool, small, independent coffee places that were awesome. Stumptown, you're still out there. You're awesome. Wandering Goat in Eugene, Oregon, you're amazing. You're Yurgachev. Oh, it's like a divine gift. Ethiopian Yurgachev in general, Ethiopian coffee in general, is a divine gift. That's all I have for today, People's Guide to the Cthulhu Mythos. You can track us down on People's Guide to the Cthulhu Mythos. .wordpress.com, People's Guide to the Cthulhu Mythos. .tumblr.com. You can email me at People's Guide to the Cthulhu Mythos at gmail.com. Let's see. Are we on Twitter? Yeah, we're on Twitter. We're at PGTTCM. That's People's Guide to the Cthulhu Mythos. Or you can follow me directly at Drunk Satan Robot on the Twitter. Let's see. Oh, you know how I hate Facebook? Guess what? I'm on Facebook now. So if you goggle People's Guide to the Cthulhu Mythos on the Facebook, you'll find us. Let's see. Plugs I want to make? Plugs to me. Check me out. I'm fresh. Other plugs? Blurry Photos? Listen to their podcast. They're awesome. People's Guide to the Cthulhu Mythos is what you're listening to right now. It's awesome. X Hour Podcast or Hour with Your X Podcast. It's awesome. Dead Authors Podcast with Paul Tompkins. Great. Greg Proops. Anything he does, amazing. Amazing. Except for his announcer. No, his announcer in episode one, Star Wars, great. The movie itself, turd. Hello, Internet. If you know CGP Grey or... Oh, man, what's Brady's YouTube? It doesn't matter. Hello, Internet. Check it out. Harmontown. I Fucked Your Mom. Rap Battles. Shadowrun. Great. Cult Film Club. Highly recommend it. Comedy Bang Bang. And what else do I listen to? Oh, I just got back into Welcome to Night Vale. Awesome, awesome, awesome fun. Indoor Kids with Kumail Nanjiani, which, speaking of indoor kids, I'm so excited that Wet Hot American Summer is coming to Netflix. I am going to watch the crap out of that. But first, I'm going to watch the crap out of BoJack Horseman second season. Or is it Horseman? I think it's BoJack Horseman. Hey, Max, I'm trying to do a podcast here. Can you hold it down? Sorry, I've got a 200-pound Great Dane in the back. Yeah. Oh, one last podcast I wanted to talk about is FNH's Cthulhu podcast. He's been doing The King in Yellow and just finished up an old-style story called Green Mantle. I can't remember if it's World War I or World War II era. And, oh my God. You need to listen to Henry and Heidi. It's Hank Rollins and his assistant, Heidi May, talking about everything from how Henry Rollins got involved with Lollapalooza to Henry Rollins and the stuff that he did with RuPaul that never got released, unfortunately. They did Funky Town together. Yeah. Go on YouTube and check out Lynchland. That it would be Liam Lynch's old video podcast that I don't think he's doing it anymore. And he isn't doing any new Syphilin Ollie, but he's always doing something. I think he's got a new album coming out because, holy crap, there is so much new Liam Lynch coming out every other day on the YouTube. And also, he's got his Raven character. That's so Raven. No, not that Raven. He's got that Raven character who does, like, talks about vape pens a lot. Like, it's Liam Lynch taking a dump on the whole vape thing. Yeah. Anyway, that's it. Speaking of Liam Lynch, here's some more Liam Lynch. And before I get too far, thank you for listening to People's Guide to the Cthulhu Mythos. It really means a lot to me. And I have to say, this is my best episode yet. Best episode. Tell your friends about it. And I look forward to seeing you in the future. Email me if you want me to do some other aspect of the Cthulhu Mythos or something that you think would make a good second segment. I'm thinking I'm going to try and get someone, a guest, but not really a guest because he's kind of my BFF, talking about the Gothic tradition and Arthur Macken and that kind of stuff. All right. We'll talk to you later. Have a good one. Dudes. Ugh. I may edit dudes. No. All right.